The Christian brief on behalf of Jesus basically has two prongs, two aspects to it. The first one we looked at last week, the appeal to the miracles that he allegedly did. Tonight we're going to look at the second prong, the second aspect of the Christian case for Jesus, which is our famous C circle, right? This circle here is the set of all of the passages in the Bible that Christians say prove that Jesus is the Messiah, meaning that the second prong, the second part of the case for Jesus is the appeal to biblical prophecy, claiming that Jesus fulfilled many prophecies in the Bible which validate his claims to being the Messiah. So again, what we'll be focusing on tonight is, in general, tonight is not going to be necessarily an analysis of the actual details of the case, but tonight we're going to look conceptually at how Christians try to use the Bible to make the claim that Jesus must be the Messiah because he fulfilled messianic prophecy. And that's going to be this C circle. This is what we're going to be looking at tonight. How Christians use passages in the Bible to make their case for Jesus being the Messiah. One of the claims that we hear most often, it's thrown out very casually by Christians, is that there are over 300 passages in the Jewish Bible that prove that Jesus was the Messiah. That's a number that's often thrown out. I hear it every day practically. There are over 300 prophecies in the Bible that prove that Jesus was the Messiah. Some people actually claim there are over 600. Now, the truth of the matter is that this number is very similar to the kind of number you'll hear when cleaning products are sold. Like, you know, there's spray cleaners, and it'll say, our spray cleaner has over 1,000 uses. Now, when you think about it, it really has over 1,000 uses. Well, it can clean your bathroom windows, it can clean your bedroom windows, it can clean your garage windows, it can clean your, you know, living room windows, it can clean your car windows. Obviously, this number, 1,000, is a ridiculously inflated number. It doesn't have really anything more than one use. It cleans things. But the number 1,000 sounds very, wow, 1,000 uses. You know, it's a miracle product. So the use of big numbers is often meant to either intimidate people or to impress people. My brother, who's a lawyer, told me that one of the things that lawyers sometimes do to make an impressive showing is to, like, a whole wheelbarrow of evidence, to wheel it into the room, and people, oh, look at all that evidence. Now, it could be 15 million pages of nothing, but people are very impressed by packaging. They often say in advertising, sell the sizzle and not the steak. So when Christian missionaries claim that Jesus fulfilled over 300 or over 600 prophecies, don't get excited by that number. As a matter of fact, when I speak to missionaries directly, we have conversations, I'll say to them, look, let's be honest with each other. How many prophecies do you really believe Jesus fulfilled? And they'll say, in moments of honesty, well, maybe 10, maybe 20. They very quickly are willing to admit that most of those other prophecies are, you know, cotton candy, right? You ever eat cotton candy? You bite into it, disappears, nothing there. So we're going to see tonight that it's very easy to puncture or to deconstruct these prophecies. We're going to see tonight how easy it is to puncture or deflate the vast majority of these. And at the end of the day, there are approximately 10 that we'll have to actually discuss and deal with, meaning there are 10 that are really worth analyzing. And we'll get into some of those in the rest of the course. Maybe one of them we'll do tonight. But we're going to try to analyze tonight and understand tonight is more conceptually how to approach the Bible and understand how missionaries misread the Bible, how they manipulate the Bible, and how they use the Bible inappropriately to try to prove what they are selling. I have to state, just as a, it's important to understand that if you ever speak to Jews that have converted to Christianity, not just Jews, by the way, if you ever speak to just Christians in general, and they share their story, what they call their testimony, they will often resort to quoting verses from the Bible. very, very common that people who convert to Christianity will open a Bible and show you all the passages in the Bible that they insist led them to Jesus. And Jewish people are no different. I've had many, many Jewish people I've had this discussion with. When I ask them their story and how they came to faith in Jesus, they'll tell me, well, because of what the Bible says and the passages in all the prophets. I want to tell you that in reality, I don't think there have been many Jews, if any, that I've ever met that converted to Christianity because of what the Bible says. I think that you probably would have to look very, very long and hard to find any Jew that converted to Christianity because of what it says in the Bible. How do I know this? Because let's think about it for a moment. If you were to meet today a typical Jew who's converted to Christianity, and you were to have met them a week before they converted, right? Let's say I was to meet a young man who's embraced Jesus, and he tells me, you know, I came to believe in Jesus because of all the prophecies in the, you know, the Bible, in Jeremiah and in Isaiah and in Ezekiel, and I were to have met that person a week before they converted, right? And let's say I saw them eating dinner at a McDonald's restaurant, and I walked over to them at the McDonald's, and I opened up my Bible, and I showed them in the book of Leviticus, in the book of Deuteronomy. I would say, maybe you're not aware of the fact, but the food you're eating is prohibited in the Bible. Now, do you think that most of these people would get up and run out of McDonald's because I showed them a verse in the Bible? Or if I ran into one of these men, let's say a week before they converted to Christianity, and I asked them, did you put on tefillin today? Did you put on phylacteries, the leather boxes that Jewish people wear on their heads and on their arms? And they say, no, I haven't put them on today. And I'd say, well, aren't you aware of the fact that in the Bible it says that we're supposed to be doing this? You know, I don't think most of them would say, oh, where can I get a hand? You know, where can I find a pair? Because the truth of the matter is that the vast majority, I would say close to 100% of the Jews who end up converting to Christianity were not people who took the Jewish Bible very, very, very seriously before they converted. It's not as if these are people who believed that the Bible is the Word of God that they have to follow very carefully, and they just happened not to be in Hebrew school that day when all of these prophecies pointing to Jesus were taught. But now that they've been enlightened and the missionaries show them all these prophecies, they say, oh, really, the Bible says that? I gotta convert. What happens, though, is that, and I think I've explained this, Jewish people generally convert because their experience of Judaism was shallow. They never experienced Judaism as a deep, rich, spiritual path. They usually were never acquainted with the idea that in Judaism, the goal of everything we do is to get close to God. These are people that probably never heard that in their lives. And their experience of Judaism was basically as a culture, a heritage, a tradition, an ethnicity, an identity, but they never experienced Judaism as a deep and profound spiritual path that could lead them to an intimate, close, personal relationship with God. They then meet Christians who offer them that kind of deep spiritual path. They speak about having a personal relationship with God through Jesus. And that is usually what sells Christianity to Jews. It's not that it's proven to them intellectually, it's that they now have a feeling that their life is going to be more spiritual. They have a feeling they're going to have a closer relationship with God. It's basically the fulfillment of personal feelings and spiritual feelings. Now the problem is that people don't like to make decisions in life that jeopardize and destroy relationships, especially close relationships, let's say relationships with their family and relationships with their best friends. People don't like to make decisions like that, or they don't like to think they've made decisions like that, which can have disastrous consequences because it felt good. No one likes to feel that they've made decisions that had such disastrous or serious impactful effects on their relationships, meaning to lose family and lose friends. You have to appreciate when Jewish people come home and tell their mommy and daddy, "Mom and Dad, I found Jesus," their parents don't dance the hora. They're not thrilled. And usually families deteriorate. The relationships get very strained. Many Jewish people who embrace Jesus will tell you that they lost most of their friends because their friends think they're crazy. So people don't want to make a decision like that and think to themselves just because it felt good. People want to think about themselves that they made a decision because it was real, it was true, it could be proven. It's not just my emotions, it's true, and I can prove it. So what happens to most Jewish people is that the Bible didn't lead them to Jesus. But once they embrace Jesus, then the Bible becomes very important. Because now they have what they can point to as the intellectual matrix for their conversion. I mean, now they can say to people, "Oh, this wasn't an emotional decision. This is provable. It's in the Bible. I can show it to you." So again, what I want you to realize is that even though many Jewish people will speak about coming to Jesus because of what the Bible says, it's almost never the case. They didn't go from the Bible to Jesus. They went from Jesus to the Bible. And now that they believe in Jesus, now all of a sudden the Bible becomes very, very important to them. Understand that. Finally, what we're going to try to understand now is, again, how this C circle works. Again, these are all the passages in the Bible that Christians like to appeal to in order to point to the Bible proving their theology and proving their beliefs. So what we're going to try to do now is understand how this circle works. How does it work? Basically, the short version of this class tonight is to understand that the Christian approach to the Bible is based upon circular reasoning, meaning that they don't start with the Bible to try to understand what does the Bible actually teach and then see if the Bible points to Jesus. That's not what happens. What happens is they approach the Bible with a preconceived assumption. Their assumption is Jesus is the Messiah and other beliefs in Christian theology. But that's the starting point. The starting point is the conclusion, the assumption, the assertion, Jesus is the Messiah. Once they have that conclusion in hand, they then go back to the Bible to try to see how they can mine the Bible, how they can mine the Bible, and shoehorn Jesus back into the Bible in order to prove what they accepted originally without the Bible. You know, it's like Alice in Wonderland. They had, in Alice in Wonderland, first they had a verdict, then the trial. That's not the way things are supposed to be done. First you'd have a trial, and then the verdict. I mean, first what you should do is analyze, what does the Bible teach about the concept of the Messiah? What is the Bible's teaching about the Messiah? And then let's see if Jesus fits into that parameter, into that paradigm. But the missionary approach to the Bible is no. They assert from the very beginning, Jesus is the Messiah. Now, let's go back to the Bible to find proof for that belief. The famous story that was told to illustrate this was actually told by the Maggid of Dubna, the Dubna Maggid, who lived about 300 years ago. And he was a famous storyteller that always was able to have a parable to suit any idea that he wanted to illustrate. And he actually told this parable, I'm going to tell you, to illustrate how he was always able to have a parable at hand. But I'm using his parable to teach something else. So he told a story about someone who went into the forest, and he sees a tree, and on the tree is a target, right, with the concentric circles. He sees the tree, and there's a big target on the tree, and right in the middle of the bullseye, right surgically in the center, is an arrow. It wasn't like there were two or three arrows that were slightly off-center. There's one target and one arrow right in the bullseye. It's pretty amazing. How did someone get it exactly in the bullseye? But then he walks further and he sees another tree. And the tree has a target and again one arrow right in the bullseye. And he sees tree after he sees 10, 15 trees like this. and the person can't believe it. How did anyone shoot so accurately? So he finally sees someone carrying a bow and arrow, and he says, let me ask you a question. Did you shoot those arrows back there? And the fellow says, yes, I shot those arrows. He says, I got to shake your hand. You're amazing. How did anyone get so good at shooting arrows? You should join the Olympic team. And the person says, well, sheepishly, he says, I'm not really that good. You see, what I do is I shoot my arrow into the tree, and then I draw the target around the arrow. Right? That's basically what happens in the way Christian missionaries approach the Jewish Bible. So they have this circular reasoning, which leads them to quote passages in the Bible out of context. That we're going to see tonight is the major flaw with missionary appeal to the Jewish Bible. Again, because we saw in our class on the real Messiah that this set here was, we said, exclusive and exhaustive, meaning there really aren't any other passages in the Bible that speak about the Messiah. We saw that this set over here exhausts every passage in the Bible that speaks about a descendant of David who will come in the future. There isn't anything else. So what happens is when Christians assemble this set over here, the C set, these are passages which are not talking about the Messiah. These are passages that are not talking about the Messiah, but because the Christian is so invested in trying to prove what they already believe, they transform these passages which are talking about other topics, and they insist, no, those are messianic prophecies that Jesus fulfilled. So again, what we're going to see is that the circular reasoning, where the missionary begins with their assertion, they begin with their conclusion, Jesus is the Messiah, and now I have to go back to the Bible and find things in the Bible that sound like Jesus, leads them to read the Bible out of context. And the passages that they look at, we're going to see, are not passages, when you study them in context, that really are talking about the Messiah. Now, there's a technique that you can use to help discover this. The Talmud actually says, there's a famous passage in the Talmud where the rabbis say, every time a heretic approaches our Bible to use it to prove something that they want to prove, the rabbis say the answer is generally nearby. Because what happens is, for the missionary to read a verse out of context, what they're ignoring usually is the context. What happens is the missionary comes and they parachute down into the middle of a chapter. They will seize upon a sound bite of one or two verses that sound like Jesus, but they ignore the rest of the chapter, which makes it very clear it's not talking about the Messiah and it's not talking about Jesus. That's basically what we're going to try to do tonight. So we're going to start on page 2, and you'll see it says section A, quotations out of context. Quotations out of context. So we're going to begin on the left-hand side of the page, Matthew chapter 2. Now Matthew is the first of the four Gospels. The Gospels are the biographies of Jesus. They're the first four books in the Christian Bible. Matthew is the first of the four, although most scholars will say that Matthew was not actually the first one to be written. Most scholars will say that the first one to be written was Mark around the year 70. Matthew, most scholars will maintain, was written around the year 80. But for some reasons, whatever we don't know exactly, Matthew appears first. In chapter 2, we're going to basically be looking at what is referred to as the infancy narrative about the life of Jesus. The infancy narrative. So what happens here is that Herod, who is ruling Judea, Herod was the, somewhat Jewish. He wasn't clearly a Jew. He was Idumean. But he was ruling the Jewish people in the area of Judea. And he hears a report from wise men who came all the way from the east. He hears a report that the Jewish Messiah is born. And he tells these wise men that I want you to let me know where the baby is because I want to go serve this baby. Obviously, King Herod had no interest in serving or worshiping the baby. So the wise men became aware of the fact that Herod was up to no good, and they leave. They don't tell him where the baby is. And what happens, we're going to start on verse 13, is that Joseph, who was apparently the father of Jesus, we'll see that that's not so clear in a few minutes. In any event, Joseph, who is the alleged father of Jesus, he has a dream. An angel comes to him in a dream and says, "Arise and take the young child and his mother and flee into Egypt and stay there until I bring you word, for Herod will seek to destroy the young child." This, again, is not rocket science. Anyone who is thought to be the Messiah is a great threat to the ruling authorities. The Messiah means he will be the Jewish king. If someone else is the Jewish king, that person's going to be out of a job. And even though little Jesus is just an infant here, we're going to see, at least in this story, Herod is very threatened. So Joseph is told in a dream, get out of Dodge, get out of town, it's getting very hot there. And he arose in verse 14, and he took the young child by night and went down into Egypt. And he stayed there until the death of Herod. If Herod was the great problem, meaning Herod was the danger, so as soon as Herod dies, right, you can go back to Judea. You can go back. So what happens in verse 15? He stayed in Egypt until the death of Herod. Now watch very carefully. This is going to be what the Christian Bible uses as what they call a fulfillment formula. Matthew is now going to tell you that this story of Jesus having to go down to Egypt, it didn't just happen to happen. Matthew's going to claim that the Jewish Bible prophesied, the Jewish Bible predicted that this would be something that happens to the Messiah. Again, understand this well, that according to Matthew and according to what we'll be seeing tonight, the claim is being made that the story didn't just happen to happen, but that it had to be because the Jewish Bible predicted many, many, many years earlier that these things would happen to the Messiah. So that's what Matthew does here, right? That Jesus had to go down to Egypt and stay there until Herod died, that it might be fulfilled, which was spoken of the Lord by the prophet, saying, and now he quotes, "Out of Egypt I've called my son." Now again, whenever the Christian Bible says that something was fulfilled, the only book that the Christian Bible quotes from is the Jewish Bible. So the way the prophecy works is to appeal to the Jewish Bible. That's the way the missionaries are working with this technique, right? To claim that Jesus fulfilled prophecies from the Jewish Bible. They're not telling Jewish people, you know, you should believe in Jesus because the New Testament says he's the Messiah. Christians understand that Jewish people don't necessarily accept the New Testament. So what they're going to try to do is say, but it's in your Bible. It's in your Bible where all these prophecies are found pointing to Jesus. So this is the first one we're going to look at tonight. The claim that in the Jewish Bible there was a prophecy saying the Messiah would be someone who comes out of Egypt. Now, the quote that Matthew gives you is, quote, "Out of Egypt I've called my son." Now the question is, where does the Jewish Bible say that? Where does the Jewish Bible say that? So the answer is that it's from the prophet Hosea. Prophet Hosea was one of the Jewish prophets. And if you look on the right-hand side of the page, in the middle, you'll see Hosea chapter 11, verse 1. When you read chapter 11, verse 1, you'll see, "When Israel was a child, then I loved him, and I called my son out of Egypt." So God is speaking here through the prophet Hosea. And God said, when Israel, the Jewish people, when Israel was a child, meaning when they were young, in the youth, in the infancy of their history, I loved him. And here, interestingly, we're going to see this comes up many, many times in the Bible. The Bible refers to the Jewish people as a singular. Right? It doesn't say, I loved them. God says, I loved him. And I called my son out of Egypt. God is referring to who as his son? Israel. Now, don't think this is just an aberration in the book of Hosea. Just go up for a minute to Exodus chapter 4, verses 22 and 23. Where God says to Moses, "You shall say unto Pharaoh, thus says the Lord, Israel is my son, my firstborn." Right? God says to Moses, you tell Pharaoh, Israel is my son, my firstborn. And I say to you, let my son go that he may serve me. Right? So throughout the Jewish Bible, the Jewish people are referred to as God's son. So the prophet Hosea in chapter 11 says, when Israel was a child, meaning in the early days of Jewish history, I loved the Jewish people, and I called my son out of Egypt. The Jewish people, that's how our history began. We were slaves in Egypt. God took us out of Egypt. He brought us to Mount Sinai to receive the Torah. And then 40 years later, we come to the promised land of Israel. So what do we see happening here? We see that Matthew is quoting a verse out of context. That if you read chapter 11 of Hosea, you'll see what is Hosea speaking about in chapter 11. It's a chapter not about the Messiah. It's a chapter about the Jewish people, the nation of Israel. But what Matthew does is to take that prophecy about Israel and he transforms it. He exploits it. He usurps it. He, what's the word? Oh, he was in the 60s. He co-opts it, right? He tries to transform a passage which in context is speaking about Israel. And he says, no, it's talking about the Messiah. Now, how does Matthew pull this off? Matthew does something to the original verse to allow this deception to take place. What does Matthew do to allow his deception to take place? It's very simple. He took his eraser, he took the white out, right? And he deleted the first half of the verse. If you look at what Matthew actually quotes, he only quotes half of the verse. He quotes the second half where it says, out of Egypt I've called my son. And there it's not clear, well, who is the son? Who is it referring to? By leaving out the first half of the verse, which speaks about Israel specifically, when Israel was a child, I loved him. He leaves that out. So he allows for the illusion that maybe it's speaking about the Son of God, right? Whatever that is. Again, that's one simple example of all I'm trying to do now is illustrate for you what does it mean to take a verse out of context. Again, when you examine the original context of the verse that's cited, it's not dealing with the topic of the Messiah. When you examine Hosea chapter 11, it's a passage dealing with the Jewish people and their history. Right? The evangelist, Matthew, takes that and he basically rips it out of its context and he shoehorns Jesus back into it, basically out of context. Let's go on in Matthew to give another example. Herod, back in Herod, right? This is before Herod died. So Herod, when he saw that he was mocked by the wise men, meaning he was given the slip, the wise men didn't tell him where this baby was. He wanted to know, where is this baby? And the wise men went away without telling him. So Herod, when he saw that he was mocked by the wise men, became very angry. And watch what it claims he did. And he sent out and killed all the children that were in Bethlehem and in all the coasts thereof. Now Matthew, in the King James translation, this is King James, didn't obviously realize that Bethlehem is not a coastal city that has coasts. I guess the King James translator didn't understand that. The better translation would be Bethlehem and all the surrounding towns. Right? There are no coasts around Bethlehem. So he went and killed all the children that were in Bethlehem and in all the surrounding areas from age 2 years and under, according to the time which he diligently inquired of the wise men. That's what Matthew claims happened. By the way, we mentioned last week, there's no historical proof or indication that such a story ever took place. We would imagine that if there was such a massacre of every Jewish baby under the age of two in Bethlehem and all the cities around Bethlehem, we would have known about it. It would have been a big story in Jewish circles. The Talmud might have mentioned it. Josephus might have mentioned it. Josephus spends 40 pages, 40 chapters, I think, actually, discussing the history of Herod, never mentions the massacre of these babies. So in any event, Matthew insisted it happened. But now watch what happens. This is what we need to look at. Matthew then says that this story, this event where all these little babies are massacred, didn't just happen. Matthew insists that it was prophesied, that the Jewish Bible anticipated it would happen, again, as a way of letting people know who the Messiah is. So Matthew says in verse 17, then was fulfilled that which was spoken by Jeremiah the prophet, saying, and now he tells you, he's quoting from the prophet Jeremiah, and he quotes, in Ramah was there a voice heard, lamentation and weeping and great mourning, Rachel weeping for her children, and would not be comforted because they are not. So Matthew appeals here to a verse in the book of Jeremiah, which speaks about Rachel weeping for her children, right? And the impression is, again, when you read Matthew, that somehow in the book of Jeremiah, Rachel was weeping for children who were killed. That's the impression that Matthew tries to create. That you have this story in the book of Matthew that Matthew insists was anticipated by the prophets hundreds of years earlier. That Jeremiah was telling you, you know what? One of the ways you'll know who the Messiah is that there'll be a tremendous massacre of little babies. However, if we look at the actual passage in Jeremiah, it's on the right-hand side of the page, we'll see what Jeremiah was actually referring to. And here you'll see that Matthew actually quoted the verse in its entirety. He didn't clip the verse like he did earlier. Jeremiah 31, verse 15. Thus says the Lord, a voice was heard in Ramah, lamentation and bitter weeping, Rachel weeping for her children. She refused to be comforted for her children because they were not. That's what Matthew quoted. But now let's continue. Thus says the Lord, refrain your voice from weeping and your eyes from tears, for your work will be rewarded, says the Lord, and they shall come again from the land of the enemy. And there is hope in your end, says the Lord, that your children will come again to their own border. So when we study the book of Jeremiah, it's very clear that Rachel was not weeping for children that were killed. She was weeping for children that were taken into captivity. She was weeping for children that were taken into exile. And God says to her, stop your crying, because those children will come back to their own land. They're not going to be in exile forever. But what happens? Matthew takes this passage out of context. He transforms it into a prophecy about the murder of children, and also that it's speaking about somehow the Messiah. Let's proceed to page 3. I'll tell you a story. Many years ago, when I was in Jerusalem for I was attending a lecture, there was three former Baptist ministers that were giving a lecture in Jerusalem that I attended. And they were talking about how they no longer were Christians, and there was a Christian in the audience who was very, very upset. And he was Jewish. He was a Jewish fellow. It was very strange because he looked like a religious Jew. He had a big beard and a black coat, he looked like a Hasidic Jew. And he gets up and he says he's bothered by the whole presentation because he has a wife that's a Baptist. And everyone at that point was wondering, this fellow has a Baptist Christian wife? It was sort of strange. Anyway, a few minutes later, the blonde sitting next to him raises her hand and she attacks these three speakers. She says, how could you three men no longer be Christians when the Bible has hundreds of passages that prove Jesus was the Messiah? She gets all excited. And they didn't want to speak to her. So they said to her, well, Rabbi Skobac sitting there in the front, why don't you speak to him after the lecture? They volunteered me to speak with her. So we went for a walk, and I sat down with her, and this is what I said. I said to her, I bet that when you read the Bible, I meant the Jewish Bible, I said, when you read the Jewish Bible, I said, I bet that you see Jesus' face on every page. And she got all excited and she said, that's right, how did you know? That's exactly what happens. When I read the Jewish Bible, I see Jesus' face on every page. Now, I'm going to tell you two things now. One that I said to her, one that I didn't say to her because I didn't know about it back then. But what I really should have said is the following. What I said to her wasn't bad either. A few years ago, I had a Russian Jew came to my office. He was very upset because his wife had converted to Christianity. And he walked into my office, and he was struck. He said, "Rabbi," he says, he saw a picture on my wall of Marilyn Monroe. So he said, "What kind of rabbi has Marilyn Monroe's picture up on the wall?" So I said, "You know what? You're standing across the room. Why don't you walk up a little bit closer?" So he walked up and he looked at the picture from up close and he says, "Oh my God, it's Albert Einstein." It's an amazing optical illusion that when you look at this photograph from far away, it looks like Marilyn Monroe. And when you get close to it, it looks like Albert Einstein. I could have said that to this woman, but I'll tell you what I said to her. I said, "Do you ever go to a museum and see beautiful paintings?" I said, my wife happens to be an artist who paints seascapes. And I said that I remember going to a museum once to a showing of seascapes. There were oil paintings. And I said it was quite amazing that when you looked at the oil paintings from, you know, a certain distance, it looked so real, it was incredible, that it looked like if you touched it, your hand would get wet. That's how real it looked. It looked like it was actually an ocean there. So I said, what happens when you go to when I was a kid, I saw the Mona Lisa. I couldn't get so close. There was, you know, there was change and there was, you know, but they kept us pretty far away from it. But I said, you see a Mona Lisa and it's amazing how real it looks, how lifelike it looks. What happens when you go up to a painting and you look right at it from just a few inches away? What happens? So you see the cracks and you see the imperfections, and basically it's an oil painting. You see splotches of oil. That's all you see. It doesn't even look like a seascape anymore. It looks like splotches of oil. And it's only able to create the illusion of a seascape from a distance. So I said to her, I said, I understand how you see Jesus on every page of the Bible, but that's because you're looking at the Bible from very far away. I said, you look like the person who saw Marilyn Monroe. It's because you're standing across the room. I said, you see Jesus because you're looking at the Bible from very far away. But I said, if you get up close and look at the Bible closely, you won't see Jesus anymore. And she got very upset when I said this. She was very upset. What do you mean I won't see Jesus anymore? She was insulted. So I said, let's do an experiment. I asked her to open her Bible to the book of Zechariah, chapter 13, verse 6. Now you have it on the page, top of page 3 here. I asked her to look at her Bible, and I said, look at the prophet Zechariah, chapter 13, verse 6. Now, this Bible that I have here, this is a Christian Bible, and it has a feature. Every time they believe that the Bible has a prophecy about Jesus, they put a little black star next to the verse. There's a little book, you probably can't see it from where you are. But this Bible has a lot of black stars. And those are all the places that they believe Jesus fulfilled the prophecy. So in her Bible, this verse in her Bible was underlined. She had done the underlining. It was yellow highlighted. She had arrows pointing to it. Like Honest Ed's, like whoop, whoop, whoop. It was unbelievable what kind of a scene was going on around this verse in her Bible. And she was clearly interested in this verse. So I asked her to read the verse, and she read it. "And you will say unto him, what are those wounds in your hands?" So I asked her, who is that speaking about? And she looked at me and she said, "You know who it's speaking about." And I said, "No, tell me, who do you think it's speaking about?" And she said, "It's speaking about Jesus." So I asked her, "Are you sure?" She said, "I'm positive." I said, "How sure are you?" She said, "I would stake my life on it." She says to me, she's so sure she would stake her life on it. So I asked her to do the following. I said, "You know, you just read chapter 13, verse 6. I said, now go back and read from the beginning of the chapter. Read the whole chapter from verse 1. And as she was reading, I was watching her face. So she's reading her Bible, I'm looking at her face, and very quickly her face turns white like a ghost. She turns white like a ghost. And I said, what's wrong? What's bothering you? She's practically shaking, and she says, that can't be talking about Jesus. That verse we just read a few seconds ago, it can't be Jesus. I said, why not? She said, because this chapter is talking about false prophets. I said, wait a second. Just about 30 seconds ago, you said you would stake your life on the fact that it was talking about Jesus. What happened? What happened all of a sudden that you're sure it's not Jesus anymore? So I'll tell you what happened. What happened is she read the passage in context. Think about it. Probably someone like this is reading the Jewish Bible. Probably a large part of the Jewish Bible doesn't really resonate with her. She doesn't know really what it's talking about even. You know, not necessarily all very interesting. So she's reading. What are those wounds in your hand? Right? There's this huge attraction. Why? Because it sounds like Jesus. Meaning she approaches the Jewish Bible with her belief that Jesus was the Messiah. This sounds like Jesus. That's a very important passage. Underline it, put yellow on it, have arrows pointing to it. But again, that's not how the Bible should be studied. To begin with your conclusion and then go back and paint a target around the arrow that you shot. First, try to understand, what is the Bible talking about? Forget about Jesus. First, read with the Bible and try to understand the Bible in its own terms. So that's another example, again, of quoting something out of context. The original context, if you read chapter 13 of Zechariah, it's speaking about the destruction of false prophets. But for a Christian who's so intent on seeing Jesus, right, they ignore the rest of the chapter, and they just zero in on that one sound bite that sounds like Jesus. That becomes a proof. Not just for her. Here's a whole, one of the most famous Christian Bibles, the New American Standard Open Bible. They've done the same thing. And many, many Christians have this verse highlighted as a prophecy fulfilled by Jesus. One more story. On the bottom of page 3, I was once at Temple University in Philadelphia. A nice woman came over to me, handed me a pamphlet. The pamphlet was called 27 Prophecies Fulfilled in One Day. She gives me a pamphlet, 27 Prophecies Fulfilled in One Day. Now, I think most people probably didn't do what I did. Most people probably ignored her, or they took it and they tore it up and they threw it on the floor, or they got angry with her, they cursed her. I don't know what most people did. I said to her, this looks very interesting. Can we study this together? She was floored. She couldn't believe someone was interested in studying it with her. So we sat down and we opened up her pamphlet, and the first page said, the very first sentence, Jesus fulfilled 27 prophecies in the Bible. The first of the 27, it said, Jesus fulfilled the prophecy saying that the Messiah would be betrayed by a close friend. Now, one thing we've learned already a few weeks ago was that the Bible never has the word the Messiah. If the Bible actually said the Messiah would be betrayed by a close friend, she'd have some case to make here. But we're going to see that in the passage she's quoting, it never mentions anything about the Messiah. But what happens? She is someone, not just her, by the way, but the Christian approaches this chapter of the Bible with the story of Jesus being betrayed by Judas Iscariot. That's how they begin. They come to the Jewish Bible with that story in hand. They know Jesus was betrayed by Judas Iscariot. They then come to the Bible, and they see here in Psalm 41, if you have to turn the page actually to page 4, it's verse 9. Even my bosom friend in whom I trusted, who ate of my bread, has lifted the heel against me. By the way, you think in this Bible that verse is going to have a star next to it? You bet. Of course, there's a star next to it. Because they see, another prophecy fulfilled by Jesus. Again, this is part of those 300 prophecies. So again, the claim is that Jesus fulfilled the messianic prophecy. The Bible tells us the Messiah is going to be betrayed by a close friend. Now go back to page 3 and just read through this chapter and ask yourself, does it ever say anything about the Messiah? The answer is going to be no. Those words never appear. And the first thing I asked this woman was the following. I said, let's do an experiment. Let's do an experiment. And this is the way I think people can be helped to understand how they're misreading the Bible. I asked her, pretend that you are reading the Bible now. Pretend that you are reading the Bible 10 years before Jesus was born. Imagine you're picking up the book of Psalms and you're reading it 10 years before Jesus was born. I asked her, if you read Psalm 41 10 years before Jesus was born, would you have thought that this psalm was a messianic prophecy? I asked her, would you have thought that this chapter in the book of Psalms was teaching you something about the Messiah 10 years before Jesus was born? And she read the thing over many, many times. And she said to me, no, I don't think I would be able to tell you that. Right? It became clear to her that what was going on is that the only reason that she saw this chapter as a messianic prophecy was that it had this one line that sounds like Jesus. But the truth of the matter is, who cares if it sounds like Jesus? First of all, think about it for a second. How many people on planet Earth have ever been let down by someone close to them? How many people have been let down or betrayed by someone close to them? Probably at least half the free world. Probably in most rooms, about 100% of the people will tell you, you know what? I really got stabbed in the back by someone close to me. So to say that it's pointing to Jesus, again, it could be pointing to almost anyone. But again, you have to appreciate to the Christian what they have as their narrative. They have their story. Jesus was betrayed by Judas Iscariot. And now they see this line in Psalm 41. My bosom friend, who I trusted, lifted up his head, betrayed me. So to them, that makes this a messianic prophecy. Right? The fact that it sounds like Jesus transforms this into a messianic prophecy. So if I ask her, how do you know this chapter in Psalms is a messianic prophecy? Now she'll say, because it sounds like Jesus. But that's circular reasoning. That's based upon your assumption that he's the Messiah. So let's go back to 10 years before Jesus and read the psalm. Now you can't work in a circular fashion. And I asked her, if you were reading it 10 years before Jesus, why would you think this psalm was a messianic prophecy? She had no answer. Because again, when you take away the ability to think circularly or to think in a backwards fashion, it won't point to Christianity, to Jesus. Then I asked her another question. I said, you know what? Let's, for argument's sake, assume that you're right. Let's assume you're right. Let's assume that this passage is speaking about Jesus. I said, but if you go back to verse 4, I asked her, do you think Jesus said verse 4 as well? Where he says, as for me, I said, O Lord, be gracious to me, heal me, for I've sinned against you. I said, do you believe that Jesus sinned against God? Because here the same person that's saying he was betrayed by a close friend, he's saying a few verses earlier, God, I've sinned against you. So I said, do you think Jesus was saying that as well? And she got so upset, she took the pamphlet out of my hand, her pamphlet that I was holding, took it out of my hand, she tore it away from me, she ripped it up and threw it on the ground. Said, who could write something so stupid, she said to me. I said, you know what, you shouldn't get so upset with the writers of this pamphlet. By the way, I have an earlier edition of that pamphlet that's called Not 27 Prophecies Fulfilled in One Day. I have a version that's called 33 Prophecies Fulfilled in One Day. It's interesting that they went down from 33 to 27, probably because some of these were so easy to puncture. But I asked her, don't just blame these Christian missionaries who wrote this pamphlet. If you look in the Gospel of John, chapter 13, verse 18, on top of page 4, this is the only place in the Christian Bible where Jesus himself claims that a prophecy was fulfilled about him. Jesus says in John 13, 18, I speak not of you all, I know whom I have chosen, but that the scripture may be fulfilled, he that eats bread with me has lifted up his heel against me. So this is the problem not with chosen people ministries who wrote this pamphlet, it's with the New Testament, who is claiming that this passage is a messianic prophecy. So again, what we just looked at, it took us quite a while, but I wanted you to understand that the most basic error that missionaries make when using the Jewish Bible is to quote passages out of context. Again, if you study the original context, the whole passage, you'll see that it's not talking about the topic of the Messiah. The second error is what we refer to here in B On the bottom of page 4, circular reasoning. Now again, I mentioned before that circular reasoning is what causes to read passages out of context. But circular reasoning will also kick in even when the passage in context is speaking about the Messiah. Let me give you an example. This is not a verse that exists in the Bible. There is no verse that says this. But imagine if you found a verse in the Bible that says, the Messiah will come. Imagine you have such a verse in the Jewish Bible. The Messiah will come. Now, the Christian missionary is going to say, who is it talking about? The missionary will insist it's talking about Jesus. Now, if you ask this Christian, why do you think it's talking about Jesus? All it says is the Messiah will come. It doesn't tell you who the Messiah is going to be. They'll say, yeah, but it has to be talking about Jesus because he's the Messiah. And if you ask them, well, how do you know he's the Messiah? They'll say, because the Bible proves he's the Messiah. And you ask them, where does the Bible prove it? They said, look here, it says the Messiah is going to come. That again is circular reasoning, meaning that it's putting the cart before the horse. So even if you found a verse in the Bible that is speaking about the Messiah, the Christian will assume it's talking about Jesus. Look, for example, in Isaiah chapter 11. Isaiah chapter 11 is an actual messianic prophecy. Isaiah 11, where it says in verse 2, the Spirit of the Lord will rest upon him, the Spirit of wisdom and understanding, the Spirit of counsel and might, the Spirit of knowledge and the fear of the Lord. His delight will be in the fear of the Lord. And Christians will say, it's talking about Jesus. And we'll say, how do you know? They'll say, because the Spirit of God was upon him. Now, the point is that anyone could claim that this could apply to anyone that they believe in. You can rest assured that the Unification Church believed that it applied to Reverend Sung Young Moon. They'll say, Reverend Sung Young Moon, the Spirit of God was upon him. So again, anytime you're convinced that someone is the Messiah, you'll say that any passage which does speak about the Messiah must be speaking about that person. Deuteronomy 18 is an interesting example. It doesn't speak here about God raising up the Messiah. It speaks about God raising up a prophet for the Jewish people. You should know, by the way, that Muslims use this verse in Deuteronomy 18 to prove that Muhammad is a prophet. Because they say, you see, it says that God's going to raise up a prophet, that's Muhammad. Right? Again, anyone that you think is the prophet, is the Messiah, you can just plug them back into any passage speaking about the prophet or the Messiah. You haven't proved that that's the case, though. It's just an assertion. So we have, again, many, many passages in the Bible where, because Christians begin with their conclusion, they begin with their assumption, Jesus was the Messiah, they then plug him back anywhere they think the Bible is speaking about the Messiah. Let's move on to page 5. So page 5 now is the third error. Again, we're trying to examine tonight typical errors that missionaries make when reading the Jewish Bible. Error number 1 we saw was reading passages out of context. Error number 2 is circular reasoning. Error number 3 is mistranslation. This actually does not come up that frequently. It happens a number of times, but when it happens, it's a serious problem. Look on the left-hand side of the page, and this is the King James Version of Psalm 22. King James Version of Psalm 22 on the left-hand side of the page. And I'd like you to read verse 16, where it says, again, you should be on page 5 now, left-hand side of the page, Psalm 22, King James Version, verse 16. For dogs have compassed me, the assembly of the wicked have enclosed me, they pierced my hands and my feet. Now, if you thought Zechariah 13 was a humdinger, which speaks about what are those wounds in your hands, here it speaks about having hands and feet pierced. And so obviously, the Christian immediately thinks about the crucifixion of Jesus. And so missionaries will very quickly point to this passage in Psalms as a prophecy proving that Jesus must have been the Messiah. Why? Because they say, Psalm 22 tells you that the Messiah is going to be crucified, it's going to have his hands and feet pierced. Jesus had his hands and feet pierced, ipso facto, he must have been the Messiah. Now, we have so many problems here. Problem number 1, which we just mentioned a few moments ago, is that even if this chapter was a messianic prophecy, which it's not, but even if it was, all it would be saying is that the Messiah would have his hands and his feet pierced, right? Does that prove that Jesus is the Messiah? You should know that the Romans crucified over 100,000 Jews. Jesus was not the only one to be crucified. Over 100,000 Jews crucified. And then there were other times in Jewish history where Jewish people had their hands and their feet pierced. If you study anything about World War II, one of the ways that the Nazis would kill Jews, they would line them up outside of a pit, and they'd machine gun them. The whole town might be machine gunned. When those machine gun bullets fly through these Jewish people, many of them probably had machine gun bullets going through their hands and feet. So to say that any verse in the Bible speaking about someone's hand and feet pierced has to be talking about Jesus, again, is circular reasoning. There's nothing here that speaks about Jesus. If it's talking about the Messiah, which it's not, and if it's translated properly, which it's not, I just want to make it clear, it doesn't point to Jesus. That's an assumption that the Christian makes. The second problem, which we're not going to go into right now, is the question of context. Is Psalm 22 about the Messiah? So again, the technique to use is to say, if someone was to have read this chapter 100 years before Jesus, would they assume this chapter was about the Messiah? What about this chapter would lead someone to believe it was about the Messiah 100 years before Jesus? Absolutely nothing. So that's the issue of context. But we want to use this chapter to illustrate a different problem. If you look on the right-hand side of the page, right-hand side where it says Psalm 22, verse 17, Jewish translation, you'll notice, by the way, that in the King James, it's verse 16. In the Jewish Bible, it's verse 17, because the pagination between the Jewish and Christian Bibles is often, especially in the book of Psalms, off by one verse. In any event, look at the Jewish translation. For dogs have encompassed me, a company of evildoers have enclosed me, like a lion at my hands and my feet. Or like a lion, they are at my hands and my feet. In the middle of the page, on the right hand and left hand side of that, is the Hebrew. Ki sivavuni klavim, because dogs have surrounded me. Adat mireim hikifuni, an assembly of evil people have surrounded me. Ka'ari, like a lion, yodai viraglai, my hands and my feet. Now, person that is being ripped apart, tortured, is not going to necessarily speak in full, clear sentences. They're probably going to be blurting out phrases. So the person says here, like a lion, my hands and my feet, probably meaning like a lion, they're at these lions, these evildoers are at my hands and my feet. But now we have the following scenario. I'm claiming that the word ka'ari in Hebrew means like a lion. The Christian says, no, ka'ari means they pierced. And what the Christian will say to me is, you know, Rabbi Skobac, you are so terrified of seeing Jesus in your Bible, you're so afraid of seeing Jesus that you mistranslate it to say like a lion. That's what the Christian will say to me. You're so afraid of seeing Jesus, it will lead you to mistranslate ka'ari and say it means like a lion. And I might say to the missionary, et tu, missionary, you are so obsessed with seeing Jesus that leads you to mistranslate it to read they pierced. And now we have what you can call a discussion, a tie, right? It's my word against your word. How do you solve this impasse? How do you decide who's right and who's wrong? So the technique is very simple. If you have a word in the Bible and you're not clear what it means, the simplest thing to do is go to every other place that word appears, right? And see what it means there. Meaning, if this was the only place the word appeared, then you're stuck. You're stuck. But if the word appears elsewhere in the Bible and you can see what does it mean in those other places, maybe that will help you decipher what it means here. So let's look at where it appears elsewhere in the Bible. On the right-hand side of the page, just on top of what we just read, Isaiah chapter 38, 13. This, by the way, is from a Christian translation. I cry for help until morning. Like a lion, he breaks all my bones. Shiviti ad boker ka'ari. Kein yishaber kol atmotai. So here, the Christian translation of ka'ari is like a lion. Why? Why all of a sudden they're translating it the way Jews translated the word in Psalm 22? And you'll see every single time this word appears in the Bible, even the Christian translations render it as like a lion. Now that might be helpful in telling you what the word ka'ari really means. Ka in Hebrew is like, ari is a lion, ka'ari, like a lion. So again, this is an example of what we would call mistranslating the Hebrew Scriptures. Turn the page, we'll come to our last example. So basically, there are going to be four techniques tonight that we're learning. So now we have D, fabricated references. This is the most egregious. This is the most alarming of all the techniques. Here, it basically entails making up a verse that doesn't exist, right? Or taking a verse and not mistranslating it, but totally distorting the verse itself, meaning not quoting it properly. So here we have fabricated references where either the passage is not quoted properly or it's totally made up. This is from the end of chapter 2 in Matthew. So we studied Matthew chapter 2 earlier, right? We saw Jesus going down to Egypt, and we saw Jesus after the death of Herod is able to come back to Israel, and that's what happens now. So Matthew chapter 2, verse 19 to 23. When Herod died, an angel of the Lord suddenly appeared in a dream to Joseph in Egypt and said, "Get up, take the child and his mother, and go to the land of Israel, for those who were seeking the child's life are dead." Right? Now you can go back, because the person that was the problem is dead. So when Joseph got up and took the child and his mother and went to the land of Israel, that's what he was going to do, go back to where he came from. But when he heard that Archelaus was ruling over Judea, because they had come from Bethlehem. Bethlehem is in Judea. When he heard that Archelaus, the son of Herod, was ruling over Judea in place of his father Herod, he was frightened, he was afraid to go there. So after being warned in a dream, he went away to the district of the Galilee, which is northern Israel. And there he made his home in a town called Nazareth, Nazareth. So watch what happens now. So that which had been spoken through the prophets might be fulfilled, quote, "He will be called a Nazarene." So Matthew basically is saying that the whole story of Jesus not being able to go back to Bethlehem and having to go live in Nazareth, that wasn't just something that happened arbitrarily. Matthew is claiming that it was prophesied, it was predicted, that it was anticipated hundreds of years earlier, where the Bible said, the Jewish Bible said, he, the Messiah, will be called a Nazarene. He'll be someone from the city of Nazareth. Now, the question that anyone that's familiar with the Bible would ask is, really? Where does the Bible ever say that the Messiah will be called a Nazarene? Where does the Bible ever say that? Now, I have in this Bible, I once bought from the Christian bookstore, Messianic Prophecies Fulfilled in Jesus Christ. And they take you right away. He will be called a Nazarene. It's one of the prophecies. He'll be called a Nazarene. Where does the Bible ever say he'll be called a Nazarene? They tell you. Judges chapter 13, verse 5. And I quote that for you right here. This is where the Bible says he will be called a Nazarene. Now hold on to your seats, because this might cause you to fall out of your seat. Judges chapter 13, verse 5. For lo, you will conceive and bear a son, and no razor will come on his head, For the child shall be a Nazarite unto God from the womb, and he will begin to deliver Israel out of the hands of the Philistines. Now, this is one humdinger of a claim. First of all, let's think about what you might call quoting out of context. The Christian missionary is asserting that this is a passage about the Messiah. But anyone who bothers to read Judges chapter 13 will know this is a story about who?
Samson.
This is a story about Shimshon, about Samson. And Samson's parents are told, right, you're going to conceive and bear a son, and no razor will come upon his head, for the child will be a Nazir, Hebrew Nazir, in English Nazirite, to God from the womb. Is it saying that your child's going to be from the city of Nazareth?
No.
Of course not. In the Bible, we see it in the book of Numbers, chapter 5, there's something called, an institution called Nazirut, to become a Nazir. A Nazir is someone who, for a period of time, doesn't cut their hair, doesn't consume any wine, and doesn't come in contact with people that have died. So what's happening, if you read Judges 13, you'll see that it's not a passage about the coming of the Messiah one day. It's a passage which is speaking about the future birth of Samson. And it's not telling you that Samson is going to be from the city of Nazareth. By the way, it's spelled differently. Nazareth in Hebrew is spelled with a tzadi, a T-Z, Nazareth. A Nazirite is with a Z, with a Z, Nazir. Two different words altogether. But Judges 13 is not telling you that Samson is going to be from the city of Nazareth. It's telling you that Samson is going to be raised as a Nazir, as a Nazirite. And you'll see that it says in chapter 13 of Judges that Samson's going to deliver the Jewish people out of the hands of the Philistines, something obviously that Jesus never did in any way, shape, or form. So here is an example of the gospel writer inventing a passage in the Bible that simply doesn't exist. And there are other cases which we're not going to have time to do tonight. In the few minutes we have remaining, I'm going to try to accomplish the near impossible. We're going to study one of the more important Christian messianic proof texts. I'll tell you that over the past 20 years, it has definitely fallen into disfavor. 20, 30 years ago, if you spoke to almost any Christian missionary, this would be one of the most popular passages from the Jewish Bible they would quote. Nowadays, they're almost embarrassed by it. And you'll see tonight why they're embarrassed by this passage. So let's look on page 7, from the first chapter in Matthew. Again, the second chapter in Matthew, which we just did, spoke about the infancy of Jesus. The first chapter of Matthew speaks about the birth of Jesus. So Matthew chapter 1. Now the birth of Jesus Christ was as follows. When his mother Mary was espoused to Joseph before they came together, she was found to be with child of the Holy Ghost. Now, this passage often confuses Christians because they ask themselves, wait a minute, if Joseph and Mary were married, why had they not slept together? Right? It's the kind of passage where if you read it, it doesn't sound normal. It says that when his mother Mary was espoused to Joseph before they had come together. So apparently before this, they were not sleeping together. So what the Christian reader often doesn't understand is that 2,000 years ago, this is the way Jewish marriages were contracted. A husband and wife would basically enter into an agreement to get married. That was called kiddushin. It wasn't a wedding. It wasn't a marriage. It was what we call today an engagement. But the engagement back then had the legal force of being a marriage. And what they would do is they would get so-called engaged, betrothed, and then the husband would spend, or the future husband would spend a year getting the house ready, getting his livelihood together, getting the house ready. And after a year, he would then bring his bride into the house and they'd begin living together. So for that year, they were legally married, but they didn't live together. Legally married meant that if they wanted to dissolve that marriage, they had to get a divorce. Legally married meant that if she messed around with someone, it wasn't cheating on her boyfriend, it was adultery. So that was the way things took place back then. And that's what Matthew 1 is describing. That when Mary was espoused to Joseph, meaning during that 1 year period, before they started living together, she was found to be with child of the Holy Ghost. Meaning Joseph came to visit her one day and found her to be great with child, as the New Testament might say, right? She was pregnant. And Joseph, her husband, being a just man, he was a nice guy. He was not willing to make a public example out of her. Meaning normally if she got pregnant and it wasn't him, he knew he hadn't slept with her. That's adultery. She could be killed. She could have been executed. So he didn't want to make a public example, desired to put her away privately, which means he basically said to her, look, Mary, you're a nice girl. Just get out of town. Move to Ottawa. Move to New Jersey. Just go and start your life over again. Don't say anything. Just show up. You're pregnant. What happened to your husband? He died. Whatever. But you don't have to say anything. Just move and just start all over again. That was his desire. He wanted to send her away privately. But when he thought of these things, behold, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in dreams, saying, Joseph, you son of David, fear not to take Mary as your wife, for that which is conceived in her is of the Holy Ghost. It's not some man that impregnated her. She was impregnated by God himself. And she will bring forth a son, and you will call his name Jesus, for he will save his people from their sins. Now listen carefully. Now all this was done that it might be fulfilled. Again, we are familiar with this. This is the fulfillment formula in the Gospels, right? All of this happened to fulfill that which was written in the Jewish Bible. All this was done that it might be fulfilled, which was spoken of the Lord by the prophet, saying, quote, now he's quoting again from the Jewish Bible. Behold, a virgin shall be with child and shall bring forth a son, and they will call his name Emmanuel, which being interpreted is God with us. Now, let's try to understand, first of all, how the Christian uses this verse from Isaiah, and we'll begin to deconstruct it. The first thing that is used here is the claim that Mary giving birth to a son without the participation of a human father was predicted by the Hebrew scriptures. And they quote Isaiah, behold, a virgin will be with child. So that's referring to Mary, who was not, she had never slept with a man. She's still a virgin, even though she's pregnant through the Holy Spirit. That's the first thing that the Christians try to use with this verse in Isaiah. And the second thing is to claim that this child she's going to give birth to is not going to be a regular Jewish baby. It's going to be God himself. Pretty strange, by the way, that God impregnates you and then you give birth to God. But they say because this child's name is going to be Emmanuel, Emmanuel means God with us. So it's going to be a baby who's God with us. Now, you should know, first of all, that this is a mistranslation. I'm not going to focus on this part of it tonight. But the Hebrew, the translation should be God is with us, not God with us. But the baby's name is reflecting the fact that God is with us. And we'll see why that's an important name. You'll also notice that Jesus was never called this. It would have been better had the Christian Bible named Jesus Emmanuel. In any event, what we want to look at is the first part of this, which is the use of this verse in Isaiah to prove that the Messiah is born of a virgin. Now, I'm going to again show you now that this appeal to the Jewish Bible fails on a number of accounts, mainly context and mistranslation. So those are the two major problems here. One is that it's taken out of context. Number two, it's mistranslated. So let's first see the context. I often have Christians ask me, Rabbi, did you ever read Isaiah chapter 7, verse 14? That's the one I just quoted here. Right, in Matthew 1:23, they're quoting Isaiah chapter 7, verse 14. So many Christians have asked me, have you ever read Isaiah chapter 7, verse 14? And I usually respond by saying, well, actually I have, but have you ever read chapter 7, verse 1? Meaning that I ask them, what is the context of that chapter? I ask the Christian, what's going on in chapter 7 of Isaiah? You should know that almost none of them ever knew. All they know is that one verse pulled out of context, right? They just landed with a helicopter on that one verse in the middle of chapter 7, and boom, that's the virgin birth of the Messiah. And I asked them, What is going on in that chapter? What's happening in chapter 7? They're clueless. So let's look quickly at chapter 7 in context. Follow along on the bottom of page 7. And it came to pass in the days of Ahaz, the son of Jotham, the son of Uzziah, who was king of Judah. This is important to know now. At this time, when this story is written, the Jewish nation was split into two. There had been a civil war going on since after the children of Solomon, and the Jewish nation was split into two. There was a northern kingdom and a southern kingdom. The southern kingdom was called the Kingdom of Judah, comprised of the tribe of Judah, the tribe of Benjamin, and part of the tribe of Manasseh. And you had the 10 northern tribes, which was called the Kingdom of Israel, sometimes also called the Kingdom of Ephraim, either Ephraim or Israel. So you had a war going on. You should know, it wasn't just a friendly split up. There was a civil war between the 10 northern tribes and the 2 southern tribes. So what happens here? It came to pass that when Ahaz, who was the king of Judah, what happened? That Ritzin, who was the king of Syria, Syria is north of Israel, and Pekah, son of Remaliah, king of Israel, went up toward Jerusalem to wage war against it, but could not prevail. What happens in this chapter is that the southern kingdom of Judah is being attacked now by an alliance of the 10 northern tribes and Syria, meaning Syria, this great world power, formed an alliance with the northern tribes of Israel, the kingdom of Israel, and they were going to go and attack the southern kingdom of Judah. Now you can imagine, how are you going to feel if you're down south in the kingdom of Judah? Here you are, the 2 southern tribes, and now coming against you are the 10 northern tribes plus Syria. You can imagine that they were very frightened, which we're going to see what happened. And it was told to the house of David, saying, Syria is allied with Ephraim, and his heart and the heart of his people trembled as the trees of the forest trembled because of the wind. They were shaking like trees. And the Lord said to Isaiah, so God says to the prophet Isaiah, go now to meet Ahaz. You, Isaiah the prophet, go to meet the king. You and your son Shar-Yashub, your son, at the end of the conduit of the upper pool on the road of the fuller's field. And you shall say to him, listen and calm yourself. So the prophet says to the king, listen, I know you're frightened, but be calm. Don't be afraid. Listen and calm yourself. Do not fear. And let your heart not be faint because of these 2 smoking stubs of firebrands, because of the raging anger of Ritzin and Syria and the son of Remaliah. Why? Because Syria, Ephraim, and the son of Remaliah have plotted evil against you, saying, what is their plan? They've said, let us go up against Judah and provoke it, and let us take it over, and let us crown a king in its midst, the son of Tabeel. Thus says the Lord God, it will not succeed, nor will it come to pass. All their plans will not come to pass. For the head of Syria is Damascus, and the head of Damascus is Ritzin. And within 65 years, Ephraim will be destroyed. 10 northern tribes will be destroyed. And it will no longer be a people. And the head of Ephraim is Samaria. And the head of Samaria is Remaliah's son. If you do not believe me, surely you will not remain. And once again, the Lord spoke to Ahaz, saying, again, God now is speaking to the king and says, ask for yourself a sign from the Lord, your God. Ask it either in the depths or in the heights above. So God says to the king, listen, don't just take our word for it. Ask me for a sign. And Ahaz says, I will not ask, and I'll not test the Lord. I don't need to ask for a sign. And he said, listen now, O house of David. Is it little for you to weary men that you weary my God as well? Therefore, the Lord himself will give you a sign. Behold, the Hebrew doesn't have a virgin. It says, behold, the young woman is with child, and she will bear a son, and she will call his name Emmanuel. That's the verse in question. Butter and honey shall he eat, so he may know to refuse evil and choose the good. For before the child will know to refuse evil and choose the good, the land whose 2 kings you dread will be abandoned. So what is the basic prophecy here? The basic context of this chapter is that the kingdom of Judah, the southern 2 tribes, the southern kingdom of the Jewish people, is under a very dangerous attack. They're under a great threat. And the king is given a sign. The sign is, look, king, there's a young woman who's going to give birth. And before that baby knows good from evil, that's not very long. Kids can learn good from evil within a few years. God says, before this little kid learns good from evil, these two nations attacking you will be destroyed. That's basically what's going on here. If you want to understand the storyline of chapter 7 of Isaiah, it's the political threat to the kingdom of Judah. This is, by the way, about 700 years before the Common Era. Political threat to the kingdom of Judah. They're being attacked by these two great powers, and God says, look, I'm going to give you a sign. There's a young woman, and this woman's going to give birth to a baby, and before the baby knows good from evil, these two threatening nations will be destroyed. So the context here is not about the Messiah. It's not telling us about when the Messiah is going to come, who the Messiah is going to be. It's simply telling us that God is reassuring the Jewish people living in the southern kingdom of Judah. They're going to be safe. They're not going to be wiped out. And the sign is going to be simply the birth of a child. And before the child learns good from evil, these two nations will be wiped out. It's obviously absurd to say that this child is Jesus. Can you imagine? Jesus is born 700 years later. So Isaiah comes to the king and says, look, king, I know that you're terribly worried, but don't worry, because in 700 years from now, a woman's going to give birth to a baby. That's not relevant to him. Obviously, the whole story is one that takes place in his lifetime, and it's made for him and for the Jewish people at that time. It's not dealing with something that happens hundreds of years in the future. That's the first problem, is one of context. By the way, if you look at the map on page 8, you'll see the southern kingdom of Judah. On the left-hand side, it says Judah and Beersheba. Judah should have been written a little bit bigger. And up in the middle is Israel or Ephraim, the kingdom of Israel or the kingdom of Ephraim. And the north is Syria, Aram. So that was the lay of the land back then, and those two northern powers were coming down to destroy the kingdom of Judah. That's problem number one. Problem number two, and again, we could probably spend several hours on this one chapter in Isaiah, but I just wanted to illustrate these two problems here. Problem number one is taking something out of context. Problem number two is translation. If you go back to page... I'm sorry. Don't go back now. Go forward to page 9. By the way, on the top of page 9, you'll see where this prophecy was actually fulfilled. You'll see in the Bible, in the book of Kings, where these two northern kingdoms are actually destroyed as per Isaiah's prophecy. But now on to translation. If you look right below the line, I have for you the Hebrew of chapter 7, verse 14. And you all know that Hebrew is read from right to left, so we're going to go from right to left together. Lachain, therefore, Yitain Adonai, God will give lachem to you, ot, a sign, right? Therefore, God will give you a sign. Hine, behold. Here's the word in question. Ha-alma. Now, this is an important thing to observe. He in Hebrew is the direct object. It's called the he ha-yidi'ah. It's the English word the. So it's not just a young woman, it's the young woman. Why is it the young woman? Because it's referring to someone that King Ahaz knows. If it was referring to someone he didn't know, he'll have no idea when this prophecy is going to be fulfilled. So the prophet tells him, the young woman, it's someone he knows. In Hebrew it's called the He HaYidiyah, the He designating knowledge. You know who it is. It's the young woman, not just a young woman. You'll notice, though, that what Matthew does, when he quotes this, and he mistranslates it to say virgin, but he leaves out a definite article. Matthew doesn't say the virgin. Matthew says a virgin, right? When Matthew mistranslates the word, he doesn't just mistranslate from young woman into virgin, he eliminates the direct object. He eliminates the hey hayidiyah. Because obviously, this is no one that, Mary was no one that King Ahaz knew. So he has to have it saying a virgin, right? It can't be someone that the king knew. That was 700 years before Jesus. So one thing to note is that the Matthew translation leaves out the direct object. But the Hebrew says, not the virgin, but the young woman. Let's go on for a moment. Hara, not that she will become pregnant. She is pregnant. She is with child. The Yoledet Ben, and will give birth to a son. Now watch what happens. In Isaiah, it says, the Karas, she will call. Shmo, his name, Emmanuel. If you go back to Matthew, who names the baby in Matthew? In Matthew, it's not she will call. In Matthew, it says, check it out. Matthew translates it, and they will call. Meaning that Matthew is forced to remove this sentence from its actual context. Because if it's the woman that Isaiah was actually speaking about, she could never name Jesus. So Matthew was forced to wrench the whole passage and make it much more indefinite. So they could be speaking about something happening in 700 years. But now the key word. In Hebrew, the word Alma means a young woman. How do we know Alma means a young woman? Very simple. Hebrew has male and female forms for nouns. So for example, there's a Yeled, a young boy, a Yalda, a young girl. There's a Talmid, a boy student, a Talmida, a girl student. Right? Hebrew has a male and female form of nouns. So the noun Alma, Alma, is the feminine form of the word Elem. Elem for a boy, Alma for a girl. You can go to the Bible and look up every time the word Elem appears. It appears many times. And you'll see Elem always is translated as a young man. Not a young virginal male, just a young man. Here I have on the bottom of page 9 a number of examples where Elem simply means a young man. It's not dealing with his sexual experience. It's only dealing with his age. All you know is that it's a young man. Please turn to page 10. We actually have places in the Bible where it's clear that Alma cannot be a virgin. So for example, in Proverbs chapter 30, Solomon writes, there are three things which are too wonderful for me, four which I do not know. The way of the eagle in the air, the way of a serpent upon a rock, the way of a ship in the midst of the sea, and the way of a man with an alma, with a young maiden. Now, if, first of all, what do these three things have in common? So an eagle in the air, once the eagle passes, there's no sign anymore the eagle was there. These are all examples of something that once the event takes place, there's no sign that it ever took place. So an eagle in the air, once the eagle passes, the air doesn't tell you there was an eagle here. And a serpent upon the rock, once the serpent slithers off the rock, there's no sign there was a serpent on the rock. And the way of a ship in the midst of the sea, once the ship passes, there's no sign there was a ship there. And so too, the way of a man with a maid. Now, if she was a virgin, there would be a sign if there was a man with her. She'd be bleeding. So here's an example of where Alma clearly does not refer to a virgin. But more importantly, there is a Hebrew word in the Bible that does clearly and definitely mean virgin, and it's the word that the Bible uses when it wants to be clear it's speaking about a woman's sexual history. The word is besula or betula. On the bottom of page 10, you'll see that there are many passages in the Bible where you are interested not just in her age, but in her sexual experience. So for example, the passage in Deuteronomy speaking about a man that marries a woman thinking she was a virgin, and he wakes up in the morning and he notices that she's not a virgin, he's upset. So there it uses the word betula, right? Specifically interested in her virginity. Please turn to page 11. If we had more time, I could show you many, many more reasons that we know that Alma does not mean a virgin. One of the indications of this, by the way, is that most of the Christian translations of the Bible coming out now acknowledge the correct translation of Isaiah. So here I have for you 10 recent Christian translations of the book of Isaiah, chapter 7, verse 14. None of them translate Alma as virgin. They all admit that the correct translation is a young woman. Here's the Christian counterattack. The missionary says to us, wait a second, Rabbi Skobac. Don't blame us for mistranslating the Hebrew Bible. aren't you aware of the fact that when the rabbis themselves translated the Bible into Greek, the rabbis translated the Bible into Greek, they rendered the Hebrew word Alma in Isaiah into the Greek word Parthenos. And Parthenos means virgin. And this was done many, many years before Christianity. This took place around 200 years before the Common Era. So they say, don't blame Christianity for mistranslating Alma into virgin. The rabbis themselves, when they translated Isaiah, translated Alma as Parthenos, which means virgin. That's a typical Christian counterattack. There are two problems with it. Problem number one is that the rabbis didn't translate Isaiah into Greek. All of the information we have about the Greek translation of the Bible, it's called the Targum Shivim, the translation of the 70, because it was rendered by 70 rabbis, or the Septuagint. It was only of the five books of Moses. This we find in the Talmud, says this, and in the famous letter called the Letter of Aristias. The rabbis translated the five books of Moses into Greek, but we don't know who did the rest of the Bible, the rest of the Hebrew books. So they can't give the rabbis credit or blame for Isaiah. We'll get back to Isaiah in a few minutes. The second problem, which is even more problematic, is that if you are familiar with ancient Greek, which is called Koine Greek, the word Parthenos does not mean virgin. Anyway, when I told you it means virgin, none of you challenged me, because I assume that you're not in the room here experts in Koine Greek. But in ancient Greek, the word Parthenos simply means the same thing that Alma means in Hebrew. It means a young woman. So, for example, when the Septuagint did the translation of Genesis 34, I have it on the bottom of page 11, it's a story of the rape of Dinah. Dinah was the daughter of Jacob. When the Bible speaks about Dinah being raped, it refers to her as a Parthenos after she's raped. Clearly, she's no longer a virgin, and yet the Greek translation refers to her as a Parthenos. Also, on the bottom of page 12, I have for you the passage in the Talmud. It's Tractate Megillah, pages 9a and b, which shows you that the edition that we have today of the Septuagint is not the same thing the rabbis did. Because the Talmud shows you the rabbis made a number of editorial changes in the text. And those editorial changes which the rabbis made do not appear in today's Septuagint. You should know, by the way, that the Jewish people never used this Greek translation. The rabbis themselves were forced into doing it, and they declared a fast day. They thought it was a catastrophe that they had to translate the Bible into Greek. They made it into a fast day. So we, as a Jewish people, never used this translation, and we never preserved it. It was only preserved by the church. So whatever the church preserved clearly isn't accurate, because what the church has today doesn't correspond to what the rabbis actually did when they translated the Hebrew into Greek. You'll find those changes, again, listed in the Talmud here on page 12. Let's go on to page 13 here. This is from an introduction to the Septuagint version. This is a Christian version of the Septuagint into English. But notice what it says at the very bottom of the page here. The variety of the translators, meaning the variety of those people who translated the Jewish Bible into Greek, is proven by the unequal character of the version. Some books show that the translators were by no means competent in the task, while others, on the contrary, exhibit on the whole a careful translation. The Pentateuch, the five books of Moses, is considered to be the part best executed, while the book of Isaiah appears to be the very worst. Okay, page 14. Here you have a passage, a segment from the Hebrew-Greek Key Study Bible by Spiros Sohiatis, who's just about the greatest Greek scholar today. And he tells us in his commentary here a number of things which you can read at home about the context of chapter 7 in Isaiah, but also the fact that the word Parthenos does not mean virgin. So again, this is not Rabbi Skobac sharing this with you. This is the greatest, or one of the greatest scholars in ancient Greek today, and he's a Christian, by the way. Also, turn to page 15. You'll see two excerpts from two different Christian books. One is the Oxford Companion to the Bible by Bruce Metzger, where in the underlined passage on the left-hand side, he says the Hebrew word used Alma means simply young woman without any implication of virginity. And if you go to the right-hand side of the page from a book called The Apostles' Creed by Stuart Briscoe, he says, number one, that Matthew takes this particular story totally out of its context. And on the bottom, it's perfectly true that Alma does not necessarily mean a virgin. Okay, let's conclude tonight by just sharing a few more points. On page 16, the second counterattack by the Christian. Listen carefully. The Christian will say to me, Rabbi Skobac, give me a break. You're claiming that Alma is just a young woman and that there was no virgin birth? So if there was no virgin birth, what kind of a sign was it? God said to the king, I'm going to give you a sign. And the Christian missionary assumes that if it's a sign, it has to be supernatural. So they're saying it couldn't have been a regular birth, a young woman giving birth. It had to be something that was unusual, supernatural. It had to be a virgin birth. That's the missionary counterattack. The answer is very simple. We know one thing in the Bible and in general about signs. A sign in the Bible does not have to be supernatural. As a matter of fact, aside from the miracles in Egypt, none of the signs in the Bible are supernatural. Every time the Bible speaks about a sign, it's not supernatural. But one thing is clear about a sign. It has to be visible. You have to be able to see it, right? If a sign isn't visible, it's not a sign. How would a virgin birth be a sign, right? You have Mary wheeling little baby Jesus down the street in her carriage, and someone says, oh, what an adorable little baby. He must be the Messiah, because obviously, Mary, I know that you were a virgin when you gave birth to him. You can't see whether a woman's a virgin. Mary was not walking around Palestine with a board-certified gynecological examination sticker, certified board virgin. A virgin birth would simply not function as a sign because you can't see it. So you can see that when Joseph came home and he saw Mary pregnant, he didn't say, praise the Lord, she must be the mother of the Messiah. He thought she was cheating on him. And he was very nice. He was going to just send her away. But a virgin birth would not be a sign. So the Christian argument doesn't hold water. They're insisting again that for it to be a sign, it has to be supernatural, not true. For a sign, it has to be visible, not supernatural. And on page 16, I have examples of signs that are not supernatural. On the top of page 17, we'll see something which is very interesting, that even though the Jewish Bible says nothing at all about a virgin birth, we know that in the ancient Hellenistic and mystery cult religions from 2,000 years ago, many of the pagan mythologies back then had a belief in a virgin-born savior. So we observe that the doctrine of the virgin birth, we're told, without which no prophet or savior God could be divine incarnation, was so common among ancient cults that it was impossible for any religious founder to achieve acceptance without it. It was indeed unknown in Brahmanism or Judaism, but these exercised little or no influence on the gospel Jesus. In the mystery cult, in Zoroastrianism, in Buddhism, all saviors, past, present, and future, were incarnate gods, born of human virgins, etc. So this was a very common idea in the pagan world, not part of the Jewish world. The next passage, you can read at home, it's from Maimonides, where he writes in his epistle to Yemen about reading passages in the Bible out of context. I recommend you study his passage carefully. Look on the bottom of page 17. When I found this passage, I danced for 2 weeks. This is from a missionary book called Yahushua ben David by Walter Riggins. Again, he's a Christian missionary. It's a book that is written to help Christian missionaries target Jewish people. But look what he writes. He says, let me repeat this point. There is no self-evident blueprint in the Hebrew Bible which can be said to unambiguously point to Jesus. He says it's only after one has come to believe that Jesus is the Messiah, and more specifically the kind of Messiah that he is, does it all begin to make sense and hang together. He's admitting here that their approach to the Bible is circular reasoning. It only works if you start off believing in Jesus. Then I would say, so why bother? If you already believe in Jesus for whatever reasons, why the need to prove it? You already believe in it. So he's admitting here that their proof texts are basically based upon circular reasoning. Two more passages and we'll close for tonight. There is a Messianic Jewish newspaper called the Messianic Times. And what's interesting is that I've often pointed out that modern Christian commentaries to the Bible don't accept the idea that Isaiah is speaking about a virgin birth. And you can show it in many, many Christian commentaries. Usually, what missionaries will say is, well, those are all liberal Christians. They're all liberal Christians. They're not really real believers. They're not real Bible believers because they don't believe the Bible is the Word of God. So that's how most Christian missionaries will dispense with, they'll dismiss Christian scholarship. However, I found this article written in 1997 by Michael Rydelnik, who runs the Jewish Studies program at Moody Bible College in Chicago. And he writes the following, I'm reading you this, the underlying portions. He says, some scholarly followers of Yeshua, now he's calling them followers of Jesus, he's not dismissing them as non-Christians. He's saying there are scholarly followers of Yeshua. They're really believers. They're not liberal. Who are taking the Messiah out of the Hebrew Bible. He's saying that there are real believers in Jesus and they're scholars and they are taking Jesus out of the Hebrew Bible. I'm convinced, he says, that an interpretive approach that negates messianic prophecy is becoming prevalent among many scholars who believe in Yeshua. What's happening? These are Christians that are being honest, and they're admitting, you know what? Our proof texts don't really prove anything. And we don't really have proof for Jesus in the Bible. These are only things that make sense out of context after you already started believing in Jesus. He says, these believers adopt views that find it hard to see Messiah in the Hebrew Bible. I wonder why they have such a hard time seeing Messiah. It doesn't mean Messiah in general. It means Jesus is the Messiah in the Hebrew Bible. The answer is very simple. The reason why these Christians are having a hard time seeing Jesus in the Bible is because he's not there. That's why they're having a hard time. There's no Jew that's forcing these people to have these problems. It's not as if these are Christian scholars that are half Jewish and half Christian and the Jewish part of them is acting up. These are people that are Christians, and they believe in Jesus. They don't deny Jesus, but they're honest, and they say, but you know what? Notwithstanding the fact that we believe in Jesus, we can't force him into the Hebrew Bible. He's just not there. Finally, one last article, and we'll conclude with this. And please read it when you go home. I'm often asked by people who take this class tonight. I'll tell you what happened to me. I taught this class that we're taking right now in Philadelphia in about 1985, I think. Giving this class at the University of Pennsylvania. And there was a missionary sitting in the back of the room. After the class is over, he was feeling a little bit deflated. And he says, Rabbi Skobac, you don't understand. You don't understand. He said, the New Testament writers were engaging in midrash. Now, what happened is, I was able to effectively puncture the use of the Jewish Bible by the gospel writers. I was able to show that they had misunderstood the Jewish Bible and they were misinterpreting the Jewish Bible. They were misreading it. And he wanted to defend it by saying, Rabbi Skobac, you don't understand what was going on. Those gospel writers were engaging in midrash. I'll tell you what he meant in a minute. And I said to him, you're 100% right. You're 100% right. What's the problem? You see, there are two basic ways you can read a passage in the Bible. One is called pshat. Pshat means the simple, direct, literal, surface meaning of what it says. Meaning you read a passage, what does it say? Simple. A simple, straightforward meaning of the text. That's called pshat. Midrash means your poetic, subjective, figurative, symbolic interpretation of what you suspect or you think the Bible might be alluding to. Meaning that it's not what the Bible actually means, but you're saying that symbolically it could refer to something else. So he's saying to me, that's what the gospel writers are doing. Because I was showing that the gospel writers clearly didn't understand what the text actually meant, and he was agreeing. He was saying, yeah, but they were using midrash. Now, Midrash basically is saying that you can spin anything to mean what you think it symbolizes. For example, let's say the passage in the Bible speaks about there were 10 sheep. There were 10 sheep. And you say, it refers to the Ten Commandments. That's your interpretation. That's your suggestion. There's nothing in the text which tells you the 10 sheep in this passage are symbolizing the Ten Commandments. But you want to make that connection. So I said to this missionary, I said, you know what the problem is with Midrash? The problem is that a text that can mean anything means nothing. Once you have the license to subjectively and symbolically and poetically spin and interpret something in a symbolic way, it can be symbolizing anything. And the problem is that that has no probative value, meaning you can only prove something with the simple, straightforward meaning of the text. Meaning that if the text speaks about 10 sheep, we can discuss, are there 10 sheep in the room? Are there 10 sheep in the room? You can actually prove something with the literal meaning of the text. But once you want to take the Bible and not use it for what it actually says, but use the Bible on a level where you're interpreting what you think it might be symbolizing, you can't prove anything at that point. It's your own subjective, poetic spin of the Bible. That's no longer proving anything. So what I do in this article is I help you understand that it could be, if we want to be generous, and we don't have to be so generous, we could say that the gospel writers are corrupt. But if you want to be generous, we could say that when the gospel writers were writing 2,000 years ago, they were well aware of the fact that they were composing midrashic literature, that they were not really understanding the verses in the Jewish Bible in terms of what they actually meant. They were spinning the verses. They were interpreting them. They were using allegory and figurative language to say what they think the verses might be symbolizing. They were aware of the fact that they were engaging in Midrash. The problem, I said in this article, is that what happened over the course of Christian history is that that distinction between Pshat and Midrash became blurred, and over the course of time, many, many Christians came to understand the gospel interpretation of the Jewish Bible as the actual meaning of the Jewish Bible. So they came to a point where Christians will tell you, no, that's exactly what the Bible means, as if they can prove something with it, where they don't realize themselves that over the course of time, their own map of reality, their own way of thinking about the Jewish Bible was distorted, where it may have started off as Midrashic. They have now elevated the level of Midrash to the level of Pshat.